The views expressed on this program are those of the producers and individuals appearing on this program and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Sun Prairie Media Center staff, its video service providers, or the staff and elected officials of the City of Sun Prairie.
My name is Jameson Rabbit, and you can see who's sitting next to me. He is the host of the award-winning Sun Prairie News program and a familiar face here on the show. It's Dan Presser.
Good. Welcome back.
And you're on Sun Prairie News, too, so
we like to share each other.
I like to make a little appearance, give a little quick review.
Makes the show much better.
Oh, I'm sure it does. So this week, sir, we got some movies. In fact, we got like one of the big movies so far this year.
Huge blockbuster.
Blockbuster season is starting. Summer movie season is creeping up upon us.
And Doctor Strange, I don't know. It's you know, he's in the pantheon of greatness for Marvel.
That he is. So let's get started with what we have on the marquee this week. We have Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness. This is the 28th Marvel Cinematic Universe film.
28 already.
It doesn't
seem
like that long ago that I was watching like Iron Man. The first Iron Man movie. Doesn't feel like it was.
You were a much younger man then.
Oh, much younger. I had hair. But this is the 28th film. It is following in the events of the Disney Plus series WandaVision and in the aftermath of the blip that we saw, of course, in the Avengers films. Doctor Strange is no longer the Sorcerer Supreme as he was in the first Doctor Strange film. He's trying to find his way in this world. His lost love, Christine Palmer, played by Rachel McAdams, has moved on. And he's been having nightmares. Dr. Strange's been having nightmares where he is saving a young girl, but things don't go great. And when a giant octopus arrives in the city and a young girl seems at peril, Dr. Strange and Wong spring into action. This young woman who he sees is a girl named America Chavez, played by Xochitl Gomez. And we find that she can travel through the multiverse, and she reveals that as she has traveled through the multiverse, every version of Doctor Strange that she has run into is a terrible person.
They're all like that. Yeah.
They're all villainous people. She also really starts in the beginning of the movie kind of bringing all the exposition of where we've been, what's been going on, trying to kind of pack it all in to explain to people what's happening before we enter the madness. And they find that in a world of magic, that witchcraft is something that they don't know how to tackle, because Wanda Maximoff is in mourning after the events of WandaVision. She's angry after losing everything and just wants to be left alone with her children, whether they're real or not. And she'll go to any ends to achieve that with the powers of the Scarlet Witch. So Chavez and Doctor Strange must find a special book that can put a halt to her destructive witchcraft and try to separate Wanda from that Scarlet Witch.
You could keep going on and on.
Oh, yeah.
There was a lot to unpack in that movie. A
lot happened in this movie.
Yeah, there was like, put the colander out and throw it all in there and see what strains out, because there was a lot going on. I mean, because I didn't see WandaVision.
Uh-oh, I was wondering, because it's kind of prerequisite viewing almost.
I saw the first couple episodes of WandaVision and then kind of fell away from it, so I wish I would have seen it.
Yeah, I'm sure. I was thinking that as I was watching it, I said, boy, you really needed to see WandaVision and maybe some of the episodes of What If to catch all the little things. I don't think the What If series was as important.
Yeah.
You would just catch little inside jokes, but WandaVision was kind of a big deal with this movie.
You kind of figured it out. I mean, you kind of figured out what was going on and everything with the character,
Wanda's character.
But for a bit there, I was like, what is going on? You know,
I was feeling that way, and I've been caught up on everything, and I was still feeling like, wow, I'm a little overwhelmed with all this. It's been a while since I watched Doctor Strange.
Yeah.
Where am I at? And there's lots of little nods and little winks to other properties and shows within the MCU.
Yeah, tons.
Several of those to me felt like they were kind of thrown away, especially there were some characters that showed up in this movie that I don't want to spoil, but I was excited to see, and they kind of felt wasted to me. And how they were treated and handled.
It's almost like marketing for marketing's sake. It's kind of like they just set up all of these characters and all of these storylines going in you know, different directions, because you can tell they're setting up the next machine, the next property that's going to be out there. So sometimes it feels like, is this a movie or is it a promotional piece to me?
Yes.
When you're watching.
And I've felt that way about a few of these movies. Yeah. That this feels like a middle section to set up where you want to go next.
Yep.
Launching. But the problem is, a lot of this in this movie, when you really think about it, most of it happens in other multiverses, so nothing really matters. A lot of the stuff that happens doesn't necessarily matter.
It's almost a cheat to me. It's almost a cheat that just makes any script possible for Marvel. And it works. It works for Marvel because you never really have to stay true to, people can die and they can come back. People can
It's a real
destroy.
Easy way to bring people back.
So it's kind of crazy. It just keeps on going. And at times this movie felt, it felt a little bit like Fantasia on steroids to me. That that whole scene with the music and everything like that, not that I want to ruin it for folks, but it's like, where's Mickey Mouse? We're talking about the sorcerer and all of that.
Yeah.
So there was elements of that to me. And not that was a bad thing, but, it was psychedelic at times.
Absolutely. And that's the filmmaker Sam Raimi, who most famous for the Evil Dead franchise, right?
Yep.
And he brought a lot of that into this. I mean, this is really, he brought a lot of his comedy horror elements, especially to the third act of this movie.
Oh, yeah.
Where it turned into a real comedy horror movie.
Yeah.
And he brought a lot of his tricks too. He has a lot of very specific camera techniques that he uses in all his movies. He brought a lot of those into this. He's a guy who hasn't made a film though in 9 years. The last film he made was Oz the Great and Powerful, not one of the beloved classics. And he also made Spider-Man 3, which killed the franchise. And this movie kind of felt at times to me a lot like Spider-Man 3, where he just started throwing a lot of characters into the mix.
That's how it felt to me, too.
A lot of it was indiscernible to me.
And, I like the Doctor Strange character. I love Benedict Cumberbatch and that character, the kind of the smart-alecky-ness of him, the weirdness of him. And you almost, in my opinion, you don't get to feel enough of that. There's almost not enough dialogue at times. Mm-hmm. There's so much action. And you want to almost hear more of his kind of wisecracks and his quips at times.
Well, and that's what you get, like, when he's working with Peter Parker.
Yes, right?
You get that relationship that's fun. One of the things I really love, though, I loved Elizabeth Olsen as the Scarlet Witch. I think one of the things that Marvel has always struggled with for me is their villains.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of them just feel thrown in for a single movie.
Yeah.
And this one, we've known her for so long, and we've seen her, and she feels like a fleshed out three-dimensional character. I understand her motivations.
Yeah.
Watch WandaVision. I understand. I'm sympathetic to some of her issues.
Yeah.
And so she felt like a real good villain, and she has some great moments, especially towards the end of the movie, where she's genuinely scary.
Yeah, I agree with you. And there was a real depth to that character, from her pain to her, her love to her power hungry feeling at times, so I felt like it was a nice job by her. And I'll be honest, the Rachel McAdams character, it took me like 10 minutes to figure out, is that Rachel McAdams or Jennifer Garner? I was
well, that felt weird to me because they tried to play it up as though this was like a great love story and he lost the love and but they weren't really a huge thing in the original Doctor Strange to me.
It
wasn't one of these couples that I was like, ooh, Pepper Potts and Tony Stark, what'll happen? What was her name again?
It must have been a comic book thing that I haven't read the Doctor Strange series. So
I felt this movie was really uneven in its tone and also kind of in its entertainment value to me.
Mm-hmm.
So this movie was like 2 hours long. It felt at times like it was longer than The Batman to me because I felt like it was just, I don't know, it felt like in the middle, it just kind of hung for a while. And I find that this movie had been reshot to death because of COVID, the timeline of the movies and shows all got moved around. So suddenly things happened. This was supposed to have come out before No Way Home.
Oh.
And so because No Way Home came out, then we got to reshoot some things to make it make sense timeline-wise.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, I didn't either until afterwards. And they're like, okay, it kind of makes sense why it would seem rocky to me at points.
I can agree with that, though. I do feel like at times, I was looking at my phone, because there was just not much to have to pay attention to. And maybe that goes back to the dialogue. Sometimes there's so much action and you're like, well, I know what's going to happen here. you know where it's going.
Yeah. I don't know. I found myself getting very excited for this Doctor Strange movie the closer we got to it and was kind of left feeling a little lackluster. I feel like this is the second best multiverse movie I saw this year. Everything Everywhere All at Once being a five-star multiverse movie.
Yeah, you really
movie.
Loved that one.
The best movie I've seen this year.
I haven't seen it yet.
This movie in comparison, really, when I compare the two afterwards, I'm thinking them over. This one lacks a lot of sincerity and heart and felt very cold to me after mm-hmm. thinking back to that one.
Mm-hmm.
Not a great one-to-one comparison.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm curious. What did you end up giving Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness?
I think I gave it a 3, or did I give it a 3.5?
Question mark score.
It's a question mark. I'm going to give it a 3 then.
All right. It's dealer's choice. You get to put whatever you want. I agree, actually. We'll see what mine says, but I gave it 3 stars as well.
Yeah.
I mean, it's fine. It's not one of the great Marvel movies, though.
I was entertained, but I didn't love it, but I'm glad I saw it.
I will probably rewatch this at some point because I feel like so much was thrown at me that I probably need to get the machete out and start cutting through the jungle with some of this stuff.
And there's a lot of jungle
that
there.
That there is.
So,
Let's move ahead, sir. What we have on the streaming spotlight this week? What do you have for us?
So we have Along for the Ride, and this is written and directed by Sofia Alvarez, and it is a teen romance based on a novel by Sarah Destin. Of course, she had the series. I'm trying to remember what the series was, but another, you know, young adult series, teen romance. And this was kind of like Gilmore Girls meets Say Anything to me. It's about Auden, who is played by Emma Pissarro, a very smart, bookish, fashionable, but aloof teenager, who's an outsider because she's never really been able to let go and have fun. Like, for instance, at the beginning of the movie, we see her and all of her high school graduate friends are going to pull off the senior prank, and of course she's just too tightly wound to do it, and she questions everything, and then she finds herself on the outside. And that's kind of the character of Auden throughout the show. She lives with her tightly wound mother, Victoria, who's played by Andie MacDowell, and, whether you like her or not, Andie MacDowell kind of plays that tightly wound mother pretty well.
That's she's kinda, super passive-aggressive in this, too.
That is right. She is the passive-aggressive mom that you might have all felt at one time. And before Auden heads off to a prestigious college on a scholarship, she goes to spend the summer with her father in a sleepy little beach town called Colby. And her father is played by Dermot Mulroney. Is it Mulroney or Mulroney?
I'll say yes to either one.
Okay. And we find out he has now a new wife named Heidi, and they have a baby daughter, and he barely pays any attention to the baby, just as we are led to believe he rarely ever paid attention to his daughter, Auden. And of course, she goes on to meet 3 girls who we see here in the dress shop, which is Heidi's dress shop. That's Maggie, Leah, and Esther. And there, from there on, you get a lot of the same type of teen angst movie things going on. You know, they're the mean girls to her at first, and then she, of course, becomes friends with them after a while. And there's also an angsty, mysterious teenage boy who rides around on his BMX bike at night, and that's Eli. And Eli and Auden are both, they can't sleep at night, so they of course cross paths, and they go off on these quests, which Auden calls them. Eli wants her to go and do things that she's never been able to do in her life, and so they go off on a quest, which kind of at times felt a little bit hollow to me, because we don't really get the whole story on the quest. It seems like they just kind of let that go, but all in all, it comes out just like they fall in love. There's some parties along the way, and it's a little love story that I think if you like rom-coms and if you like teen rom-coms, you might want to see this one. But all in all, I would say, again, Sofia, I understand Sofia Alvarez is good at these teen rom-coms.
Okay.
I did not see the other one that she did, and I probably wouldn't watch this if I was just sitting at home, but I knew we were going to review it, and my wife wanted to see it, so we watched it. I never really felt like the spark. I never really felt like this great relationship kind of charisma that you get in a rom-com between Auden and
Eli.
You
have to have that.
Yeah, who is played, Eli is played by, what's his name again? Gosh, I can't remember what his name
is. Belmont Carroll.
Yeah, Belmont Camelli. Camelli.
Oh, is it Camelli? Autocorrect.
Who actually does a pretty nice job in this, but, he's John Cusack in Say Anything. He's, Judd
Judd Nelson.
Judd Nelson in The Breakfast Club. Yeah. He's that guy who...
He's so mysterious.
Good girls stay away from.
He knows where a speakeasy pie shop is inside a laundromat. Right.
Which, whatever that was, that right? was a strange thing.
I mean,
thing.
But that's how you right. show, like, this guy's so underground.
He's so like, cool.
He's so cool. He's a high schooler, but he knows... First off, he goes to the laundromat. He washes right. his own clothes. He's a high schooler.
Yeah.
And then he knows he's friends with this guy who has a pie shop slash arcade hangout spot who I guess only Eli hangs out there.
Who? How does he make it?
Right? I don't know.
And that said, too, so we have the three teenage girls who work in Heidi's dress shop with Auden. So you now have four employees at this small little clothes shop.
That no one ever seems to be in.
That nobody's ever in. And they all work there.
About 200.
They work there every day and they get paid. And then they have this, which was actually cute. I think one of the probably the stronger parts of this movie was the relationship between the girls who work at the dress shop in Auden, and yeah. then the other teenage activities when they kind of had fun together. That was one of the stronger parts.
When they're breaking her out of her shell.
Yeah, and they're making her become more of a teenage girl.
I like that. You know, the Eli kind of challenging her to go on these quests and he's trying to be the yin to her yang, I think.
Yeah.
You know, she's the quiet, shy one, and I, you know, and she, Auden kind of starts discovering herself and finding the freedom to be her, and through Maggie also, who kind of starts as a rival and then becomes kind of a confidant,
yeah,
I feel like.
Who you end up liking.
And then, you know, teaching her to the acceptance to just be weird or whatever, be who you are. I feel like this is a really straightforward story, right?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Every generation has several of these movies. I feel like in my generation, Molly Ringwald would have starred in three of these movies.
Oh, 16 Candles or... Right,
yeah, this was a Molly Ringwald movie all day long.
You could put her in that role and it would have been perfect.
Yeah, yeah. And it's just kind of a classic story. You know, do you get a food fight in here? You better
believe
it.
Absolutely you do.
You know, do you...
You get kids frolicking around in the water? Yes, you do.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it's all the things. We got the party, you know, blah, blah, blah. But what I actually liked is the portion with Auden's story where she starts to heal other relationships.
Yeah.
I thought that was really interesting because it was more than just a stupid rom-com.
Right, yeah. And you're right. She kind of helps her dad become a better father. Not that we're going to give it all away. But
yeah, yeah.
And then she helps Eli, who has his own trouble. And he comes out of a shell that he had been in because of something that happened in his life.
That did make his shell, though, did have me laugh out loud a couple times.
Yeah.
His reaction when she would bring something up, yeah. I'll talk about it.
Yeah, I know. You have to kind of suspend disbelief, just like you do in a doctor, you know, Doctor Strange.
Yeah, right.
Sometimes you have to go, okay, they needed this to happen, so this is why it happened.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
I'm curious, what did you give it?
I end up giving this film 3 stars as well. I think it's a fun, empty calorie film.
Yeah,
I enjoyed it just enough, like I would most of these movies.
Yeah, and I enjoyed it as well. I gave it a little lower score. I gave it a 2.5 because it was very average to me.
Yep.
And I enjoyed it. I actually, you know, I didn't really think I wanted to watch it, and then I watched it, and I found myself getting into the show and getting into the characters, and you know, I enjoyed it.
Yeah, I mean, peeling back the curtain, we weren't even going to review this movie originally.
Right, exactly.
And it kind of was an emergency fill-in, and I was totally fine. I was not offended that we watched this movie.
Yeah, so. I enjoyed it.
It's still better than anything Liam Neeson's done. All right, let's move
you
ahead.
You really didn't like that movie.
I did not. Let's move ahead to the last film we have on the streaming spotlight. This week is a film from director Louis Leterrier. It's called The Takedown. This is actually a sequel, which I found out very recently, to another French film called On the Other Side of the Tracks that was made in 2012. Both of these films star the same actors. Stars Omar Sy as Ousmane, oh boy, Ousmane Diakité.
Yeah, good luck.
and Laurent Lafitte as Francois Monge. So the director, Louis Leterrier, has directed some really fun films, like a lot of American films, like Now You See Me, the Transporter films with Jason Statham.
Huh.
And he also just recently was given the new Fast and the Furious film.
Really?
When Justin Lin dropped out. So,
I could see that from some of the shots in this show.
There's a lot of this that I said, oh, this transfer, this would, this, I can see how this would play.
Yep.
So this is a French buddy cop film. Opens on Ousmane and his partner finding an underground fighting ring, and they have to arrest the biggest guy there. This guy named Diaz. Ousmane has to fight this guy, and video of him fighting goes viral, And soon he's selected to be the new public face of the police department on social media, something that he's not necessarily in love with. Suddenly, a half a body is discovered on the train tracks. You never like to hear we found half a body.
What was that guy's name again? Ken or something like
that?
Yeah,
I can't remember. Half a body is discovered on the train tracks. So Usmani's teamed up with a former partner who he has a rough relationship with. It is his former partner, Francois. They are sent to uncover the mystery with the help of a young female agent, Alice, who may also serve as a love interest, of course. And then the film basically becomes your basic bad boys buddy cop film as they chase after the bad guy for the majority of this film. And it's really as standard as it gets. You have the black guy, Usmani, who just wants to solve this case. You have the posh white guy who is more concerned with the women and getting a promotion because he doesn't like being one step below. You've got a villain, this mayor, this racist mayor who, I mean, you kind of know who the villain is through most of the movie. There's very little attempts at diversions or believable red herrings.
No.
It's kind of a straightforward shot.
It's everything I expected it to be and less.
Talk about, I mean, movies you've seen before. I mean, this is a similar, like,
this is Lethal Weapon in France, only not as good.
Yeah, it's a lot of that. One of the things that I really like, Louis Leterrier, I think he really knows how to direct fun action. We see in here, he finds that. I love, there's a lot of visual aesthetics that he uses. His use of colors, I was really drawn to. Like, when you see the lead guy, he's wearing this bright pink hoodie and this bright blue shirt. Yeah. And I'm used to your agents and all that, they're wearing dark drab colors,
suave dark clothing.
So kind of like that. You've got a scene where action starts in a laser tag place. You got a go-kart chase through a mall. You've got a chase through the mountain in this orange Jeep.
All of that action. You know, at times though, I mean there were some really neat shots and things like that, but sometimes it felt like the editors were fighting. Because there'd be like this really tight shot and then there'd be this wide shot, and it was kind of crazy, but I think that's going to translate well to.
It feels like an audition tape for a Fast and Furious movie.
It did feel that way. Now, and when you said that, I was like, "Well, of course, this is what he was doing." It has your generic buddy cop banter, things like that. I'm curious, did you watch with subtitles or did you watch with the dubs?
I watched with the subtitles on for most of the movie, and then at one point I needed to pull focus away, so I put the. Yeah. American dubbed on.
I think I did this. I started with the opposite.
Okay.
And then I was like, I don't like this guy's voice.
It's really bad.
Yeah, it was bad. So it kind of made me not like the movie even more.
It was really bad dubbing.
Yeah. And I kind of thought in general the characters were pretty thin. You know, there wasn't, you know, you obviously have, you want that mismatch character thing, like, you know, like with Lethal Weapon and these two very opposite cops, but they didn't really delve into their characters too much.
Obviously, maybe if we watch the
maybe the first one would have, right, that might have helped. When you said, "Oh, this was a sequel," I'm like, "Oh, I didn't know that."
That made me think of that because I felt the same way, and I was like, "Oh, this is a sequel I didn't know about." I'm not up on my French buddy cop movies.
Me neither.
I felt like this one dragged at points. It didn't need to be 2 hours.
No,
I felt like there was a good 90-minute movie.
Yeah, I lost interest at times.
Yeah, you know, you have this racist mayor who. I thought it would have been interesting to dig into a little more about why he just wants anyone who's a non-white refugee out of his country.
Yeah, he was like a Nazi.
Yeah, and I'm like, okay, let's dig into this guy a little bit.
Yeah.
But we really didn't. Also, a lot of gay panic jokes in here that felt like they were from a buddy cop movie from the 1980s.
Yeah, right. I agree with you.
They felt really dated. There was a ton of them in here.
Fell flat with me, too.
Those didn't work.
Even the security company has this, like, pseudo SS. Logo was almost like Nazi.
It really was.
You know, there was just a lot of stuff like that I found myself just I couldn't let myself feel the movie as well as I probably should have.
Now I will say Omar Sy, who plays the lead guy in here, is a guy who I really enjoy. I saw him in a movie 2011 called The Untouchables, which was then remade a few years ago with Bryan Cranston and Kevin Hart, about a guy who is in a wheelchair and he has an assistant who helps him. The French version is great. The Bryan Cranston and Kevin Hart movie is kind of what you'd expect. But
it's comedy.
Yeah, that is.
Yeah.
The Untouchables, the original version is, but it's a ton of heart in it. And I remember seeing that, and I believe it was nominated for foreign film, and really rooting for this guy. And then he kind of disappeared. And you just see him pop up as, like, background guy in different things.
Okay.
So when I saw he was in this, I was very excited. Like, okay, I like this guy. I'm glad he's finally getting something going on. And so I enjoyed him. I think this better movie was better than Red Notice. Yeah. Rock and Red
That's
Reynolds
not saying much,
buddy
though.
Cop movie. yeah, I don't know. I enjoyed
you liked
the
it more than
action.
I did.
I did. Yeah. I enjoyed the action, and I'm kind of curious to go back now and try and track down the original and see what the chemistry is between these two guys.
Well, now that I know there is an original, I actually would like to see it too, because I think it might help me with the character development in this, because it just all seemed very formulaic to me in terms
of
those two guys, and they didn't really give me anything to chew on. So it was, again, an entertaining buddy cop movie, but I wouldn't go out of my way to watch it.
Right, you've convinced me to change my score with that.
Sorry. Sorry.
Let's go to the scores. Dan Presser, what did you give the Takedown?
So I gave it a 1.5. I did not like the movie that much. And I'll be honest, there's times where I just didn't watch. I kind of got away from it. So maybe I liked it a little bit more if I'd really kind of locked
in. I love it. I gave it what I feel now is a 2 generous. 3.5 stars.
Wow, okay.
I would give that more of a 3. I feel like this whole show has been a 3-star movie review.
Yeah, and I could probably go to 2 on it too, especially knowing now that maybe I should have seen the sequel or the prequel.
Yeah, nothing to rush out to go rent, that's for sure. So let's take a look ahead at what is coming soon, sir, the weekend of May 20th. We've got a few movies coming out. The first one is Downton Abbey, A New Era. New movie in theaters following the events of the Downton Abbey series, as well as the movie that came out, I believe, 3 years ago. I've not seen 1 second of Downton Abbey.
Nor have I.
So whoever's doing the show with me that week, good luck, because you're watching this movie.
People tell me I should watch it. Maybe I will one of these days.
Yeah?
Yeah.
If you can watch, 6 seasons in the next 2 weeks.
Yeah, I don't have time.
I know who's not doing that. A movie that we talked about earlier this year when we were looking at our most anticipated list.
Yeah.
Men, Alex Garland's new sci-fi drama starring Jesse Buckley about a woman on a solo vacation following the death of her husband will be in theaters. Alex Garland, who made Ex Machina and Annihilation, two great sci-fi movies, has a new one, so I'm super excited
for
that.
Yeah, that one looks good.
Yeah, I hope so. Because when we talked about it, there wasn't even a poster out.
No.
It was just Alex Garland's making a new movie.
Have you seen a trailer for it yet?
I have not yet.
Nor have I. So
we'll see. It's only a couple weeks away. And then lastly, over on Hulu, we have a film called The Valet, which is a rom-com starring Eugenio Derbez and Samara Weaving about a big Hollywood actress who hires a parking valet to be her boyfriend, basically, as cover for a relationship that she is having with a married man in Hollywood. Scandalous and probably comedic.
Yeah, that name rolled off your tongue very nice.
Eugenio Derbez.
Very nice.
Like that guy. That's all the films that are coming out the weekend of May 20th, though. And after that, I promise, we're hitting summer blockbuster season. We got planes in the air. We got things happening.
Every time I go to the theater, I see the Top Gun movie trailer for that.
Before Doctor Strange, I got the Avatar 2 and the Thor Love and Thunder
Thor,
trailer.
Thor Love and Thunder, yep.
I'm super excited.
You're ready.
So those are the films of May 20th. Before we move any further, we want to thank our sponsors, though. We've mentioned them a couple of times here. The Palace here in Sun Prairie. Marcus Theaters, thank you for sponsoring this program, giving us a nice air-conditioned theater on these hot, hot days.
Felt great.
Yes, sir. Sit down in a nice, cool dream lounger. Don't screw around and hit that seat warmer, though.
No. Let that cool leather cool you off.
That's right. So we always appreciate that. Next week, I'm going to be talking about such luminary films as the Firestarter remake, Operation Mincemeat, and Rebel Wilson's Senior Year. Going to want to stay tuned for all of this. And I'll be joined, of course, by my old friend Steve Sabaki. For all these films, Mr. Presser, once again, thank you for joining me.
Glad to be here anytime.
Hey, tune into the Sun Prairie News. Dan Presser, award-winning guy. He's great. You'll get to see me talking about movies like you don't
get
enough
hit.
Of that. Quick hit review, but check it out. It's the best thing this station does, so check that out.
Yeah, you're overselling it.
No, not at all.
Bring the bar down.
Yeah. Right, okay, I got you. Hope to see you again this summer.
Oh, you will. I'm still waiting for Elvis.
Oh, yes, yeah. That's right. Coming soon. All right, let's get out of here. Until next week, though, I'm Jameson.
I'm Dan.
Thanks for watching.